Oké, jongens, ik zit hier samen met Martin Lok van Solar. We zaten net al buiten, maar er stond iets veel wind. We zijn binnen gaan zitten. Ik ga Martin nu een aantal vragen stellen over zijn nieuwe range en over zijn visserij. Martin, you said already second intent will be better. We just tried outside, too much wind.
Yep, we hope so anyway.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
But we were just talking, I ask you, I mean, you're already like for 30 years, you're active in the industry. Where do you get the energy from still? I mean,
that's what I do. You know, I've always been as keen to come up with the new products before I started this business.
Yeah.
Way before. And it just goes on and on from then. It's sort of an active mind and it just keeps flying around. It's like the mad professor in there.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's bait products, products, packaging, ways to promote things, and just to generally raise the bar and make it, like carp fishing's a pastime.
Yeah.
But I mean, enjoyable, comfortable. But ultimately, you have to be catching the carp as well to make the whole package come together.
Yeah. And
we've got such a broad range of products.
But for my imagination, some nights you're sleeping and you wake up and you have an idea, or where does it come from?
Yeah, just comes at any time, normally when you're in a good mood.
Yeah.
If you're driving down the road, or you might go to the shops to see how something's being done there. Also looking in different industries as well, not just in the fishing tackle business.
Yeah.
I don't like, as you know now, Me Too products. I like to try and just make different features. You can't always reinvent the wheel.
No.
But just to raise everything up and everyone follows suit and the whole thing becomes a nice, it's like a, more than a pastime, that's a way of life, it's a lifestyle kind of
fishing. Yeah.
And all that goes around it. So it's just been, it's my enthusiasm and motivation. We've never died on it. It's the same as it was the first day I ever started.
Okay.
So it's all good. It explodes from small things. You end up with this huge range of products that never stops evolving.
You can definitely tell that. I think 2018 is quite a special. You worked probably already 2017, 2016, maybe on this SP line, and then this year it was released.
Yeah.
I can imagine it feels like a baby to you. Maybe it's really something big. This new line, or
it's gone down really well, because when people heard that we were doing it, you get the old, here we go again, more products the same as everyone else's. But when they saw it, they're like, yeah, I like the touch of it. And it is the little details that make the difference.
Yeah.
And I won't do the same as everyone else unless I can move it up a little bit, you know, and put different features on there. There's no point in doing the same as, Me Too Tackle, it's not that.
And if you look to the SP range now, what kind of details do you think make the difference? What are you most proud of?
All the little touches, really. You know, the angles, no, things. It's hard to put a finger on anything. There's too many different angles and different areas in it. You know, the stainless steel we were known for at first, people like the features on that, the way they work. And as an angler, when I design a product, I'm also the customer by saying, does it do this, does it do that? I won't make a weak part on it, I want it to last forever.
Yeah.
The last thing I need is an angler coming round to me when I'm fishing saying, I bought that rod pod, I bought that spank six and it didn't work, this broke, that broke.
Yeah.
But it's not cheap. But the guys know they're gonna. When you've got it, you got it for life.
It should be reliable and should last forever.
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. And do you have some like really your babies in this new line, which like one or two products which you said, okay, I put so much effort in it, or it didn't work out first, but I found a way around it.
Right. The first one that springs to mind is that new Big Billy.
Yeah.
Because I slept in it last night.
The usual one with the magnetic.
Absolutely excellent sleep I had last night. Way up, we're staying here in a 4-star hotel.
Yeah.
And I've checked out the room because I'm living in that building. That's better, much to the lady behind the counter's amusement there.
Yeah.
So, that's the first one that comes to mind. But I like the precision of all the stainless steel. You know, we design every single component. I don't do the CAD, but I sit there with my man who does do the CAD, and between us, we sort it out perfectly. You know, it's like 0.01 of a millimeter you're talking about.
Yeah.
Which is why a lot of the time, you know, the Me Too copy, it doesn't work like ours does.
Yeah.
You know, we make it, it's not complicated for us, but it is complicated when someone picks up and says, can you make the same as solar? Which has happened in the past by a lot of our products.
Yeah.
But if they say that's flattery, like if someone takes your ideas, so be it. But we just come up with better ideas and that moves the whole thing forward.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah.
So are you really like a perfectionist also then, when you work with the products?
Absolutely, yeah.
It should be hard working maybe for you with the team or not, or are you not?
No, it's okay, they listen in the end.
Yeah, they have to.
We have a discussion and we realise I was right after all. So, sometimes. But no, it's a good team. You know, Jonathan's very good at what he does.
Yeah.
We have Dennis over here promoting the products, telling the guys in the shops what's going on there. We do a lot of miles, a lot of effort, you know, setting these shows up, driving through all conditions, setting, packing down again, going back again, picking up on where you were at work. There's a lot to it, but I'm not one of these. I can't work on slow. I have to work.
If you go, it's fast.
Fast and doing it, and it's all the ideas are bouncing around. You have to put them into practice. And it's a good team of people now, putting them into into the different areas. So yeah, it's working well.
And I think also the bait range is quite a big thing. I think it also is from 2018 sure. that really...
Yep. Again, lots of ideas for that. The problem for me was I haven't had so much time to go fishing. You know, it's like everyone in this industry thinks you have loads of time.
You're only fishing, yeah.
Completely the reverse of it now. Everything is like put down on the timetable almost.
Yeah.
But you know what fishing's like. If the weather's not right for it...
Yeah, you can go fishing, but it makes no sense.
And if it is right for it, you can't go because you have something else on the fire. Or, yeah, so yeah, it's a lot of a juggling act, but it keeps it fun. For sure.
But are you really like a bait addict? Are you always working on your baits,
I know from years ago, I saw the difference is having a good bait to an average bait.
Yeah.
When I very first started fishing, and it doesn't matter what rig you have. The art of it is if that bait has to be picked up before the rig works.
Yeah.
So the more attractive the bait is, the more we know they suck and blow. That's what they do for a living.
Yeah.
So the best rigs are blow them out. But if the bait's more attractive, they'll suck it, pick it up more.
Yeah.
That obviously increases your chances of percentages.
To hook him, yeah.
And that's the way it was, yeah. But, you know, I'll go on film now and say, in listening to the market and trying to improve things, the bait did change.
Yeah.
Yeah. The enhancers and attractors didn't change. But a lot of people in a lot of places, Benelux, UK, Italy, wherever, say there's more and more bream on these waters now.
Yeah.
We need the baits harder. I listen to the people, but... That's one time I shouldn't have listened.
Yeah.
So that's the bait. I'm sorry, that's how...
This is what solar is. I know it's efficient, it works.
So I tried to improve it in that way, didn't, and I hold my hands up about it, but now you can be 100% sure that these baits are absolutely original recipes that have got us where we were in our reputation in the first place.
Yeah.
There's an awful lot of people making bait now, isn't there? Loads and loads of companies. But we stand firm. You know, we've been doing this for 30 years now. The fish still eat the bait. We move on the products. We work with companies who deal with the top end of the food industry.
Yeah.
You know yourself now, the supermarkets have a lot more to offer, don't they? We use their information where possible. It's a slow progress because you have so many things available to you, you can't then bring out 10 different products.
No, you don't want to do that, no.
You just have to do one at a time and chip away at it. But, you know, where the products are, people can see the quality difference. With a bait, they're looking at a round ball and it smells, so that you have to then, like, promote that.
Yeah, it's the marketing, but it's...
Yeah, that's the way it is these days, you know. The reputation that comes from catches.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that.
But I think you don't... It's impossible to count how many big fish are caught on solar bait in years.
Yeah, an awful lot. And that club mix is absolutely legendary.
Is the club mix also your personal favourite, if you have to choose one bait? Or
you know what? When a few weeks ago, when I went to Rainbow, I said to the guys, I need some bait. And they said, which one do you want? I said, whatever we have the most of. Because I have confidence equally in all of them.
Yeah.
If I put a finger on one, if you say to me what bait you want to take tomorrow, I'm going to fish it, never used your bait before.
Yeah.
Take the club mix and pop-ups has to be probably the candy floss, top banana.
Yeah.
Any of those really. And if I was coming to your lake tomorrow, that's what I'd bring.
Yeah.
Confidence. That's it's a good starting point. But another one of the legendary flavours that gets missed a lot is the Estragon 12.
Okay.
As successful as good noctopus, I would say.
Yeah.
And they're not made off the shelf, these flavors. These are made to my specification and talking to the animal people as well and the food flavoring people.
That's really a custom, custom product, yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. And if you look to the way, I mean, are you still fishing? You just told me you were a rainbow?
I do that because the thing is, when you do rainbow or any other trip, they're booked a lot of time in advance now.
Yeah.
So that's when you go. But my UK fishing, I'm still as passionate about that. But because you can go there anytime, the ideal world for me would be going on Monday.
Yeah.
And say, right, everything's okay, all under control. Okay, I'll just do one night, maybe two nights, and back in the week. But when you go in there and it all comes at you, different things need sorting out to let the next person get all the next part of the job. I'll go next week.
Yeah.
But the problem is, the next week the same thing happens, and the next week something like that. But now I have a sort of focus down so that I do know that pretty soon I will start playing.
You have a little bit more time.
I don't mind winter fishing summer. The only thing about winter fishing is, you know, there's just the dark evenings are horrible.
Yeah, it's long evenings.
I don't want to, you know, the temperatures and that, but that's where it gets dark at 4 p.m. so I'm sitting there. But if that's what it is, that's what it is. I've always done it, and you remember the fish more when you catch them in the winter. They're often better condition.
Yeah. Nice colours.
Not so many people about, not that it bothers me either. So 12 months a year fishing.
for me, if I look, I mean, I'm a younger guy, I'm 30 years old, I read all your articles and books, etc. For me, it seems like you're really a big fish hunter. You caught lots of big fish.
The thing is, are you on the lake where you're going to fish? You can only think what you want to do on that lake. I go to the water where you're going to catch maybe 10 or 12 in a day, and that's what you want to do.
Yeah.
And I'll get the same feeling inside, because I know what I'm going to fish for. But if I choose to fish, I'll choose to go where the bigger fish are.
Yeah.
And then, I think it's because of the hunter instinct in me tells me, like, the textbook carp fishing says, you fish where the fish are. But the reverse psychology is, the big fish don't often get caught where the fish are.
No.
And that's really hard to explain to someone. That's what I like, the cat and mouse, the chess match of it all.
Yeah.
You know, try not to fish for all of them. Just try and outsmart the biggest and the best. But yeah, generally, it's all just fun, you know. So I don't mind if I'm fishing for small fish, 5-6 kilo fish. There'd be a way of doing that. I don't want to catch more of them.
Yeah, of course, you want to catch as much as possible.
If I go to another lake, I want to catch the bigger ones.
Yeah.
So it's all exciting. It depends where you're sitting. You know,
yeah.
It's no good going on the water where there's hardly any carp if you have one night every 2 or 3 weeks.
No.
The thing with these, the bigger ones, where there's often a lot less fish, is you have to go regularly just to get in your mind what's happening. Then you speak to the other guys about it, and then you get a pattern turning out sometimes, and then you have to go on a hunch.
Yeah.
You know what your gut feeling is. And that's what I like about it, it's the unpredictability.
Yeah. I think nowadays, a lot of people, you know, they book their trips in advance, like you mentioned.
Yeah.
They book for next year France, they have 1 week. To make the trip successful, they want to catch the biggest in the lake. Do you have some, like, 1, 2, or 3 tips where you say, okay, if you really want to target on the biggest fish in the lake, what would you suggest to do?
Right. One is, the biggest ingredient you have in your bait is confidence.
Yeah.
Right, take that out of the equation then. So you know, if you land on the fish, especially so when you book in advance, the weather, it's all down to the
weather. Yeah.
Right, so you have to fingers crossed. Right, number one is the bait. You go with something you're happy with. Number two, so you fingers crossed for the weather. You put me on the spot there.
Yeah.
Number three, wave the magic wand.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I think confidence is really important. So you're not a believer in changing baits all the time and the colours.
I have to.
Yeah.
And I enjoy doing that.
Yeah.
And it's sometimes people can't understand. Well, if you know you're going to catch on club mix, why'd you bring a new one? So I'm trying to raise the bar with this one. Like, for instance, the last rainbow trip I had, I think I had around 25, 26 fish. I took a new bait with me, and I'll put it against the club. Right?
So you switch the rods maybe?
Well.
And
yeah, exactly. You have to do a proper analysis and test on the thing. It's no good going down what you know will work and that's it. You're not moving forward at all. And you have to take a chance on that. Because I've taken some baits, they've not been anything like what I think they're going to be.
Yeah, it's an investment. But
yeah, that's right. So yeah, that's what keeps the whole thing interesting for me. I've got so many different things going on. You know, not just in my head what I want to do. You always have to have a plan, don't you?
Yeah.
But loads of things at the factory and the samples come through, so I get so excited. Well, the hardest thing to find is the time to go and do it.
Yeah.
But I make the time. That's for sure. You always do, don't you?
For example, I can remember from the past, I think it was you, like a kebab rig or something.
Yeah.
With pop-ups.
Like, everyone's got their own rig now.
Yeah.
I thought, just for a joke, really, I named it that, but what it was, when you're going, everyone's using spons and spots and stuff these days, and they're all got a mixture of bait. And at the time, so if you've got the boat, you're putting a mixture of bait over the side.
Yeah.
So while we're doing that, why do I want to single something out? Just
put it all on it.
Yeah, I tend not to think the fish, like, they're not stupid, but they're not that clever.
No.
Right? You can't be scared of the fish and that you're so wary of a piece of line, right? You have to use that, right? So the best thing was, if I put a mixture over the side, I put a mixture on the hook. And just inadvertently, this works so well with a small bait on the head. It's a simple rig, that multi rig.
Yeah.
With a swivel, when you put the first bait on the swivel, it stops it folding over. Because a lot of these waters, you're leaving the rods out for a long time.
Yeah.
Not doing it every few hours. And that's where a lot of these methods come from. And there's, you know, new techniques with guys that are waiting for when that chance comes along, it has to be fishing 100%.
Right? Yeah.
You can't have a doubt. So with a small bait, a bigger bait and the biggest bait on the end, the mechanics of the rigs works well because it goes, the hook goes in backwards with that rig, and when they blow it out, because of the volume of the outside bait, it throws over. Now you've maybe got 7 or 8 centimeters. Now it's relying on the baits hitting the top or the bottom of the mouth in there somewhere, just to get the fish to flinch. And with that simple rig, the hook's called 101.
Yeah.
The reason were, I landed 101 carp
before
one pulled out.
Yeah.
That's good enough average for me.
Yeah.
So the hooks being the hooks and the rig, the way the boats are set up, it's the kebab rig, it was three different boats and different colours, it's a big mixture over the side.
Oh, yeah.
And so therefore it's not sticking out to the carp so much,
okay.
If indeed he's wary of it at all anyway.
Yeah.
You know, if you put the right food over the side, you'll get more carp picking the baits up. That's the bottom line of it all.
Yeah.
Next question.
We also have to start ending this interview. I'm curious, you say, okay, I want to make more time for fishing. What is your next trip? You have something on the agenda already for this year,
yeah,
maybe?
Yeah, we've got some, these trade shows we're doing for all of September,
okay.
Some of October. So I do go to Rainbow October, as I always do.
Yeah.
People think I'm there all the time. I go in January,
yeah,
because you have a chance of a very big one, as we know. I go August,
yeah,
October, November. That's it.
And that's it.
But now I start going to different places also as well.
Okay, cool.
But you can see without taking the liberties too much, you can't do too much fishing away.
No.
You know, there's a lot of work to be done, so that stressed me up knowing that fact that that work comes first.
Yeah.
Even though when you're fishing, you're more talking the talk, speaking with the anglers, seeing what's around, what's going on there. So
yeah,
that's where you don't get the ideas sitting in the office.
But it's like an entrepreneur, you're always working, always talking to people,
yeah,
ideas
sure.
come up.
Yeah.
And
yeah, just keeps me busy, you know?
Yeah.
It keeps your mind active.
Yeah.
That's why I refuse to get old or anything. You just always think like a kid,
yeah,
energy like a kid, and do it like a kid.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not very good at being grown up.
No. But it's, yeah, I think it's important to stay young, you know, you have to stay
sure.
active.
Yeah, and, yeah, absolutely.
That's really cool. Okay, I wish you the best of all with the new range. I'm sure with these new products, retailers will be excited. I mean, they will come here in the next days. I hope the sales will go well. And we are really curious. I think, Solar is just the beginning. It feels like a new beginning, like this year. And I think for the coming years, we can expect...
We don't stop.
Quite some stuff.
Pushing, non-stop.
Thanks
very much for that.
Thanks a lot,
appreciate
mate.
It.
Yes, good luck.
Cheers.